Hi, welcome to Your Voice Legislative Report. I'm Senator George Latimer. All of us remember from elementary school and junior high school and high school getting report cards, and those report cards grade us on our tests and our term papers and ultimately on how well we did our studies. And here in Albany, there are any number of different issues that we could be graded on. In the area of the environment, there is no more appropriate grading organization than the Environmental Advocates of New York, and they're presentation every year of legislation, rating each of the different legislative bills, and then ultimately rating the legislators on the basis of how we supported or did not support the legislation is ultimately our environmental report card. So as we approach the second half and the close of the legislative session, our guest today on Your Voice is David VanLuven, who's the Policy Director of Environmental Advocates and our grader on environmental issues. David, thank you for being with us today.
It's a pleasure to be here.
You have on your website, www.eany.org, a series of bills in which Environmental Advocates evaluates them, determines if they deserve one, two, or three trees, good bills, one, two, or three smokestacks, which are bad bills. But you segment the most important issues and you call them super bills, and
Right.
You've just come out with a super bill. So let's talk about the most important environmental legislation that Environmental Advocates are advancing.
All right. Well, Environmental Advocates has been working for the last 40 years to protect New York's clean air, clean water, public health, and our treasured open spaces. And tracking legislation is one of the key ways that we do this. And the super bills are chosen not just by environmental advocates, but also by about a dozen other environmental organizations from across New York. So these super bills really do represent the priority pieces of legislation for the environmental community as a whole. And we've been doing this for about 10 years now, and I'm excited that we've got four what I think are extremely strong and exciting bills. The first would expand the installation of solar energy in New York. We're finding that our members love solar. It's cleaner. It creates incredible economic opportunities across the state. There's no reason for us not to be moving it forward more aggressively. The second is defending healthy communities against fracking. This is probably without a doubt, the most significant environmental challenge that I've seen in New York in my career, and the level of public outcry about it statewide, it's just growing with each month. The third is a bill to protect New York's children. I've got three kids. This is a bill that would get toxic chemicals out of children's products. Seems like a no-brainer. It's a really hard push. The fourth is a Climate Protection Act. This is a piece of legislation that would set thresholds for bringing down climate pollution in New York and thereby help reduce the severity of climate change across the state. And then in addition to the four super bills, we have a platform that we all agreed on, and that is campaign finance reform. As I and as the other organizations have been working to move common sense legislation through the legislature over the years, we keep running into a wall of money. And so we carry the voice of the communities across the state into the Capitol, and we run into the megaphone of corporate dollars that drowns us out time and time again.
Well, we've got, unfortunately, only 15 minutes. We've used a few of them already, but you've highlighted some very serious and some very deep environmental issues. So let's try to mine each of them just for a few seconds.
Okay.
In the area of solar energy, we certainly have in New York State a tremendous renewable energy source in our hydroelectric, which is the foundation of our energy. But natural gas, nuclear power, to the extent that they're we're affected by the coal plants in the Midwest and so forth, have been the areas that have followed hydro in terms of our energy generation. So what is the prospect that our legislation will significantly advance the use of solar energy as a clean renewable?
This I see as one of many steps that we need to take in repowering New York with modern energy technology. I mean, coal worked great during the Industrial Revolution. It's the wrong fuel for us to be using now. It's too dirty, asthma rates are too high, and it doesn't make any sense for us to be generating our power using an energy source that makes people sick, especially when we have solar and wind and other options available to us. This piece of legislation over the next 10 years is projected to provide or to fuel investment in solar energy to both increase the amount of manufacturing that takes place in New York, so it's creating new economic opportunities, but we're also looking at it potentially generating enough solar energy in New York to power over 340,000 homes across the state.
Now, this bill in the Senate is sponsored by Republican Senator George Maziarz.
That's right.
And represents a bipartisan effort in this direction, so I assume we have some optimism that this bill has a good chance of happening. I have heard that the economics behind solar are still problematic, that it's still hard to get the investment returned in a short period of time. What does the Solar Act do to help change that economics to make it more viable and more likely that we'll use more solar as part of our energy mix?
What this bill does is it creates a designated pot of state money that it's money that's already being generated through something called the Renewable Portfolio Standard. Mm-hmm. And so we have this existing pot of money, and it takes a portion of that pot and puts it into solar investment in the state. And so basically what it's doing, it's creating a guaranteed stable market in New York that will help give manufacturers and solar installers and basically private companies the confidence to invest their capital and their energy in the state to help us start a new solar revolution.
We've got two big issues to cover, but I'll cover the toxic chemicals in children's clothing and or toys, what have you,
yep.
Next. Where is New York on the continuum of other states in being able to address this concern? It's long since been my daughter was little, but I suppose I have grandchildren in the future. So we're thinking in those terms.
Right. And I've got three children myself, and it's amazing to me that this is an issue that we're actually fighting over. I mean, it seems crazy to be having cancer-causing benzene in children's products. It just doesn't make any sense to me. And this is a piece of legislation that would help the state more effectively push manufacturers to take those toxic chemicals out of children's products and replace them with products, chemicals that are safer for our children. And where's New York on the continuum? I'd say we're not as far along as we should be because we don't have it, but we're farther along than other states because I believe that we have a very good chance of getting it through this year.
I assume that this would be something we would prefer to do nationally if we could, but since we can't, we're having to go state by state to make these kinds of restrictions.
That's exactly right. But this this bill would allow the state to make better use of a multi-state database where New York and Maine and other states are paying into a clearinghouse, a data clearinghouse, because there are 80,000 toxic chemicals out there right now that aren't effectively monitored, or 80,000 chemicals that are used in children's products. And we can't do it all ourselves. And by doing it with a lot of other states, it brings the costs down for everyone because we get those economies of scale and will allow us to do more effectively get our children's products cleaned up and made safer.
On the issue of climate change, there is still a philosophical argument out there, and I think it has that left-right divide, conservative-progressive divide, where there are individuals who believe that it is not settled science, that climate change is of concern, and then many other folks who believe that this is, we're getting a global warning that we need to act on immediately. Tell me how you process the macro issue and then what the local legislation that we're talking about in New York State would do to help advance that. Once again, an issue that is national and even international in its ultimate resolution.
Well, the whole climate change debate is a fake debate that's being fueled by wealthy, powerful corporations that don't want changes to be made to the way that they do business. And they're willing to sacrifice everyone to do it. And it's appalling to me. And I have to say I was very pleased when Governor Cuomo in his State of the State came out with the frank acknowledgement that climate change is real. In my community, I live right next to Albany, it has changed the way that we talk about responding to climate change at the local level because, at least in my town, it's not an issue. The denial is gone. We're recognizing. Regardless of one is wants to view climate change as being driven by people or not being driven by people, the actions that we need to take to address climate change are just common sense. You know, it makes no sense to allow people to build in flood-prone areas. It puts people at risk, it puts property at risk, and frankly, it puts emergency first responders who have to go rescue people at risk. We need to take common sense steps to get people out of those kinds of areas, but we also, by bringing down our emissions, we're creating new economic opportunities in New York for things like solar, and it's just a common sense response to a real situation. And the few people that are getting more airplay than they merit, we just need to move beyond them.
Is there a sense that the steps that we take in this legislation is one step along a much longer path of things we're going to need to do within the state?
Absolutely. In this, the bill that is a super bill this year basically sets targets for reduction of our emissions across the economy and across the spectrum of greenhouse gas pollutants. And those are targets, and then the mechanisms for actually getting those reductions made are going to be extensive and likely complicated, and will have to happen over time.
Now, we've left a handful of minutes to discuss hydrofracking, which is, as you said, along with climate change, I would argue, are the two most dominant environmental issues when you speak to people on the
Absolutely.
Street. And hydrofracking came from nowhere in the last 4 or 5 years to becoming this kind of a dominant issue. It does have a regional break to the extent that there are voices in the southern tier economy, business community, residents that want to see it happen.
Right.
Certainly downstate in the suburbs outside of New York City that I represent, there is much more of an opposition to it. What is the right policy that you're advancing in the Super Bill as you see it?
We're advancing a two-year moratorium on fracking in New York that is coupled with one of the public health schools in the State University of New York system to do a proper public health assessment. We're almost 5 years into this process, and the state has yet to do a proper health assessment. In fact, what the Department of Health and the Department of Environmental Conservation are going through right now, they have been very specific. They're not doing a health assessment. They're doing a review of available information, most of which is not available right now because the big studies on fracking in other states across the country are just getting going. They've only gotten going in the last few months or the last year. We're not going to see any data from these studies for a couple of years yet. And as a result, New York needs to take a step back, hit the pause button, do a proper health assessment, and really get the facts about the risks to New York communities before we surge forward with this process that's proven to be extremely dangerous and damaging in other states.
Notwithstanding that I am a co-sponsor of the bill and support the concept of the bill, how do you respond to critics that say Pennsylvania is doing this, and Kentucky is doing this, and West Virginia is doing this, and New York is alone and standing back and not taking advantage of the money to be made in mining natural gas?
I my response is I'm proud of New York. Once again, New York is taking a national leadership role in doing what's right for its communities rather than that's right for a small number of powerful corporations like Exxon, which last year spent $2 million opposing hydrofracking in New York. And that money has been enough to overwhelm the 200,000 comments that came out in a 30-day period a few months ago against fracking.
Is there a false argument in your judgment, David, between the economy and the environment, which seems to be the most common opposition to environmental provisions, that it's going to hurt the economy?
The problem that I see is that usually when people think of the environment, they think of bugs and bunnies. And the reality is that when we talk about the environment, we're also talking about our health as well. And we need to be thinking about the environment, not just in terms of the beautiful places and the beautiful things that are out there, but also in the context of the clean air that we breathe, the clean water that we drink, and the safety of our communities from severe storms and climate change.
And just as a wrap-up, if anyone wants to reach out to you, give us some information about how they can contact environmental advocates here in New York State.
The easiest way is to go to www.eany.org. There's a lot of information there. There are a lot of opportunities to join and help us move this important work forward.
Thank you. We've been speaking with David VanLuven, who's the policy director for Environmental Advocates of New York, and he has, in 15 minutes, tried to touch on a world of environmental policies. We'll have you back, perhaps just before the end of the session, to see how well we've done before the final report card comes out.
Look forward to that.
You've been watching Your Voice Legislative Report. I'm State Senator George Latimer. Thanks for tuning in. We hope to see you the next time. If you have any questions at all on any public policy issue, give us a call at our district office, 914-934-5250. Have a terrific day.